Shut up. How's it going, dude?
Hey, man, what's up?
Hey, everybody, welcome to Dom's Den. Our guest in-house, right?
In the den.
In the flesh. Matthew Del Negro. Welcome.
Thank you. Thanks.
Welcome to the home. Thanks for taking the schlep over here, only to go back up north. But you're from Mount Kisco.
Yep.
Played lacrosse at Boston College, former bartender, married with two kids, recently moved from L.A. to Long Island. How did that happen?
So I was working on City on a Hill, the show
Tom Fontana.
Yeah. Showtime.
Yeah. And we shoot that in Brooklyn. So I was there. I was actually subletting in Manhattan when we first started shooting season two, which was right before the pandemic. Everything happened. I hightailed it back to L.A. I was out there for like 8 or 9 months. Then I was back here in the fall. And because of all the, you know, COVID protocols, it was like tested 3 times a week, and LA was terrible. So I never went back. I never saw my family for like 82 days straight.
So you're part of the exodus.
I'm part of the exodus. Yeah. Yeah. Apparently it was the first time in 60 years.
Hey, it could have been worse. You could have ended up in Texas.
Yeah. I know someone who went to Texas, and he was like, and I talked to him. He's in Florida now. Yeah, I was like, wait, what happened to Texas? He's like, wasn't for me, bro.
Yeah. I love it here. I always wanted to come to Austin, Texas. When the fuck did you want to go to Austin?
I've heard good things about Austin.
Honestly, I've heard good things about Austin.
Austin is different than regular Texas.
Austin's like Nashville.
But come on. People either like, I want to live in New York or I want to live in L.A. Nobody was talking about Texas 3 years ago.
No.
It's the place to be now.
Now it is.
Now,
a lot of people just want to save their money.
Staying sometimes.
Yeah, so I was back. I saw family. I talked to the Teamsters every time I'm working on a show here. I'm always like, I love them. I'm like, is there stuff shooting? And they were like, it's crazy here, and they're building studios and everything. And I was like, huh. It was like a couple of different dime drops.
And there aren't, I mean, as far as the whole COVID thing, they're on it, man.
Yeah.
I've done a few guest star stuff here and there, and they're on it.
Yeah. It was crazy in the beginning when we first started. Like, and you have a shield. And you have a mask.
It's hard.
And they do it. And I was like, oh, okay, we'll have this. Everybody's vaccinated. But then I figured once you're, you know, clear, then you go on set and it's like normal.
No.
And I was watching. I went to Video Village and I'm watching them rehearse the scene and they have all the stuff. So you rehearse with it. Oh, so the first time I went to rehearse, I'm like, what was that? you can't hear what anybody's saying.
Here's the problem with that.
You can't see the lips, though.
It's not even that. I don't know, for you, for me, the whole rehearsal is to see what the other person's doing. First of all, you have to be able to hear them, but it's important to see the person's face.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Your feet kind of
it kind of, you need to see what reactions the other person's having in order for you to be able to do that little dance, what you're going to do in that scene.
Yeah.
You know, and doing that rehearsal, yes, it's great. It's great for the camera to see where you're sitting and everything, because half the time it's for them anyway.
Right.
But it's difficult. I remember doing a couple of rehearsals, and I'm like, this is crazy. Yeah, they went from having all that stuff on to, okay, so now that we're rehearsing, you could take everything off because everybody that's there
is cleared.
Mm-hmm. So now you're rehearsing the right way. But if you're done with the scene and you're sitting in your chair and you're waiting for a setup, you're wearing everything.
Yeah.
So how's it now?
That's the way it is now.
It's now still?
That's the way. When I did an episode of Mrs. Maisel, you're wearing the whole thing. Until they call action.
Are they
really? I don't really
take it off.
I don't really get that. Because you're going to, I mean,
It's all protocol.
Yeah.
It's
I don't really protocol. Get that. Like, you're there just because everybody, if everybody is cleared and you're going to have the masks off in 5 minutes,
what's the difference?
Why
what's
not
the
have point? It off now? I don't get it. I mean, I get all of this stuff. I mean, I'm for all of it. But that part, it's like, it just seems arbitrary to me. Like, yeah. Why is it okay
little,
5 minutes from now?
It's a little tedious.
Like, let's,
yeah.
say you're in a love scene. And you're doing the rehearsal with the mask on, and then all of a sudden you're making then all of a sudden you're making
love
out with somebody.
Wrong guy.
It's a
yeah.
love scene.
I don't get a lot of love scenes.
Maybe I'll break into the house while they're making they're having the
oh,
love
that's
scene.
You'll get shot.
I'm that guy.
You'll get shot and killed as they're making love.
No, yeah.
We're rehearsing.
No, bullshit.
We don't need you until
need to see where you're gonna fall.
You were the love interest.
The camera's
in,
not looking that way right now.
Yeah, yes.
You got about 15 minutes.
You were the love interest in Mrs. Fletcher.
Yeah.
There you go.
Different.
It's
different.
It's like give me one time there.
Yeah.
Just saying, it's happened.
It's a rarity. No big deal.
My question first is like, you know, when you got out of college and then, you know, after playing sports and doing all that stuff, how'd you get into acting and what drew you there?
During college, actually. It was, I took a trip to Italy between sophomore and junior year and break up with a girlfriend, journal.
Awesome.
It's always starts with a girl. Journal, you know, soul searching.
Good job.
All right, there you go.
You can only find yourself after breaking up with a girl.
It's true.
It's so true.
Is this a
CBS kind of journal? Oh, I just got to write my thing today. Well, did you go out and get like a nice leather journal?
My sister gave me a journal before I went.
Cool.
And I still have the journal. And if you look at the first couple of entries, they were like, you know, today I went to the piazza. And then the breakup happened. I was like, I'm miserable. You know. And then I was like,
second day, two espressos, no toilet paper. And where's the fucking air conditioning?
So then I ended up junior year. I stopped playing lacrosse. I did a play at BC, and I was like, "This is what I'm gonna do."
Yeah, shout out to Boston College.
Wow.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So you didn't have any Eagles. Like, as a kid, you didn't want to be an actor.
No, I mean I didn't. It seemed like it
probably
was completely
better off that way,
out of the blue. But I look back at it now. It's in retrospect, it makes more sense. Like I played a little piano, like sing a little bit, but I never thought of it. I mean, I loved going to movies, but you know, it wasn't like I had to catch up. When I became an actor, I felt like I was brought up in all the movies of the 80s, like the Spiel, you know, like Indiana Jones, all that.
Became
an actor, I had to go back and watch all the Star Wars. I had to go back to all the 70s movies. I had a whole education to have. I wasn't thinking about it at all. It was like completely out of the blue. And then once I did it, I was like, this is it. Yeah.
And how did The Sopranos come about? I have a few questions.
Oh, that was, you know, there's the short version. The short version is there was an audition. The long version was I did a movie called The North End, like, that I got at a backstage, like, way, you know, and like the, it was the first thing that I got was
backstage. That's crazy.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I mean, I did, like, I had done so many, like, black box theater, like, you know, they don't pay you, all that stuff. Mm-hmm. I got this thing called The North End at a backstage. It was non-union at the time, but Frank Sciotta, the director, had worked as a PA on Casino. So he got the script to Frank Vincent. Frank Vincent signed on. I ended up getting like the lead of this thing. Frank Vincent signed on. It became union. He got Tony Darrow involved and Nick Puccio, his buddies, they came up. We did it in Boston on location. It went great. Went to Montreal Film Festival. It was like the first thing that I did that anybody was going to maybe see. And they had another movie about an American who goes to Italy, and he's a quarterback on a football team, and you know, falls in love with this girl in Italy, and they're like, you're going to be the lead. I was like, great. I like got bus tickets up to Boston for readings of it. I was like, all right, I'm going to do this movie. This is great. Then they got Georgia Ann Walken involved to cast it. And when she got involved, she was like, he's not right for the role. And I was like, what? And they're like, Georgia Ann doesn't think you're right. Whoa. I was like, wait, but you told me this is my role. And there was another guy that she put in, and I ended up not getting it. So for like 4 years, I was like, fuck Georgia Ann Walken. I was like, she just
to the totally point where screwed. You didn't even watch Christopher Walken movies.
Yeah, exactly. So
that's his wife.
And then Sopranos came about. I went in for Sopranos for smaller roles, like
with Sheila Jaffe,
and Georgia Ann.
I think they were they're both doing it at that
and,
time. Yeah.
And then I went in for like small stuff. And I never got it. I would go back. I'd go to producers, wouldn't get it. And then my role that I ended up getting, Brian Camerata, came around. And I remember reading it and thinking like, I got a handle on this. I went into Georgia Ann, and to her credit, she thought I was right for that. And she was like, okay, you know, we're going to do this. I'm going to send you producers. And she kind of championed me for the role. I went in for them. I was told I was the front runner, and then it was wait for a couple of days. And then they called me, they're like, there's good news and there's bad. The good news is you're the front runner. The bad news, they want to see a couple other people and they want to see you again. And I was like, oh crap. And I was like, you know, this is the Sopranos, and like I hadn't done anything real. I'd done plays and like, you know, this movie, that's it. And little student films, so I'm like, oh, they're gonna like, you know, I'm going to get screwed somehow. I go back to Silver Cup and I'm sitting there waiting, and I see like on the sign-in sheet, it's got like, there's like two guys and they're from like CAA and ICM. And I was with a small agency at the time. And I'm just like, they're bringing these guys in. They're just like bringing me in to have someone against. And I'm sitting there and I'm like, waiting to go in. I'm like this. And this guy comes by and goes like this. He's like, relax, kid. And I look up, and it's David Chase. And he walks into the room, and I'm like, oh.
Holy shit.
I'm like, you fucking relax, David. Yeah. I'm not relaxed. Yeah. So I went in, and I went in the room and did my thing, felt okay, came out, went back to the city. Like, I was in the city, and Georgia Ann, I had gone in and got a sandwich in a deli. And had no cell service. I think my cell phone was like this big at the time.
The block.
I came out and I had a message, and she was like, it was like a voicemail. And she's like, Matt, it's Georgia Ann. She's like, I just want to tell you. And I was like, fuck. She was like, you got the part, kiddo.
And
I was
holy shit. That was your pursuit of happiness moment.
Was it
a recurring at that time?
Yeah. I knew it was going to be like from the audition sides. I knew I was going to be in at least 4 episodes.
Okay.
And that didn't seem like that was it. So I was like, okay, it's going to be, you know, a substantial role. So for me, that was probably, like I've said this, I don't think I'll ever have a get like that again in my life. That I will be as excited or think, because I was naive. I was like, you know, I'm just older now. I kind of like, I've seen behind the curtain and I'm like, cool. I got the job. I'm excited, but I'm kind of like, all right, good. Yeah, you got a job. Jaded. We'll see what you're happens. With
so
it.
Your first day at work, I'm assuming it was your first day with James.
Yeah. I mean, that was a cool thing. Like everything was with him or Edie. And first day at work was Pai Oh Mai, which was not my first episode, but they were shooting out of sequence. So it was at the
that's
aqueduct.
The horse.
The aqueduct racetrack.
Yeah.
Right.
And I was it was like in February. So
that's when you guys all go watch the race.
Yeah.
The race.
Yeah. So I go, so I'm sitting in like
Joey and, Pants and I, is there
I,
too, right?
Joey Pants is in it. Yeah. Michael was in it, I think. Yeah. And But I'm like, I'm so green, you know. I've been acting for a while, but I hadn't really had.
Well, yeah,
like,
there was some heavyweight. There was some
what
veterans.
What season was that?
Yeah, it was season 4.
Oh, so they were established, yeah.
So, I get there and I'm like literally sitting in like the four banger out in the parking lot and just freezing cold. And I call my wife, who's not an actor, and she's, you know, doesn't know this business at all. And
well,
she's
tell
like,
them it's
going?
Cold. You want to go home?
She's like, how's it going? I'm like, good. I'm like, I'm out in the trailer. I'm like, it's basically like a glorified porta potty. I'm like, it's, yeah, it's dead. She's like, why don't you go in? I'm like, it's free.
Was it a honey wagon?
It was like.
Were you in the honey wagon?
It was like you know, the four bangers.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah,
where
yeah,
it's like
the
a
four
like,
banger. Yeah.
There's like a toilet. There's like a little sink, and then there's like a
yeah.
like a sliver
well, there's
of a bench.
Honey wagon too, guys, yeah. which is worse,
wagon.
Which is just a closet, right? Which I don't think any actor should be in there.
Yeah.
Regardless, they should do away with that.
Yeah, this was definitely like it was like
one step
you know,
above honey wagon.
What's that?
One step
yeah.
above the
one
honey
step
wagon.
Above honey wagon. I don't even know if it was. So she's like, "Why don't you go in?" Which was the best advice ever.
That's
so
what I
go
done.
In, and Gandolfini is like rehearsing a scene with the guy who plays Ginsburg, his CPA. So he's like doing a walk and talk, and there's a bunch of people. And I swear to God, I got up there, and when I saw him, you know, in the flesh right here, and all these people, I was just like, boom, 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 boom,
oh,
boom,
yeah.
boom, boom.
Wow.
And I'm just like, oh, fuck. You know, it was like, it was the greatest thing, because then they rehearsed that, they shot that, and by the time they got around to our scene, I was totally calm. I was like, okay, you know, kind of like talking.
What was
up.
The first scene with
first
it?
Scene was just we were like it wasn't much of a scene. It was like we're watching the race, we're cheering for
okay.
the horse, and
so, it's
so
not,
it wasn't like it was like a. It was actually perfect.
It's an easy
because
break-in.
There's no dialogue.
Easy break-in.
No,
there
the
was dialogue,
his dialogue,
but it was,
his big dialogue scene. I think in it might be that episode was when you're in the living room, right?
Yeah. So that was so I think. I might be wrong about this. I feel like we shot Pie Oh My might have been the fifth episode, and
right.
fourth episode was my first.
Right, which was
yeah, that was the audition room. Scene. But that was the audition
yeah.
scene.
Where you're selling
yeah.
in the idea.
Yeah.
yeah,
which is what I had to do for the audition. That was like the big thing. It was all the financial
big scene.
Jargon
big scene.
And all that stuff.
Yeah, yeah. It was
so,
like 3-4 page scene, right?
It was
big scene.
Something like that. Yeah, yeah. And that was. So yeah, that you know that scene was just weird. Being all of a sudden you're like in their living room, and you've been watching. It was just so surreal. The whole thing.
That's one guy. I wish I.
He
I
was
would,
awesome.
I would have worked with.
You know what? He was so cool to work with because he wasn't like yeah. I worked with him and Jimmy Smits, and they had
wow.
for different reasons. My relationship to them as a character was kind of similar, where I was like. You know, under them, like kind of looking up to them. And both of those guys took the work really seriously. They were really good guys just as humans, but they were not like doing it in a way that was like to try to look like they were good guys. They actually just were. You know what I mean? They were just like, they weren't like bullshit kind of, you know, like, making it look good in front of people, but they were really like they were, you know, I felt like I learned a ton from him. He was cool to the crew. He was like great friends with the crew. It was just like a good example.
Very generous.
Very generous.
Very
yeah,
generous.
When he renegotiated, you know,
yeah,
he
I mean,
gave them money. And
do you find that like most like established like big actors help out the little guys or
I feel like my experience, I don't know what yours is like, you know, it's like anything else. Like you meet cool people, you meet douchebags in any field.
That's true.
You know,
yeah.
And like I feel like I've been lucky to work with a lot of really cool people that were, you know, super talented, but then also good people, and then you kind of learn from that. But you just like learn how to like, you know, I wasn't that young, but I was so inexperienced that it was like just watching them operate on a set, like how they treat everybody is a great example. Like there's the acting
and it varies.
And then there's also just the, you know, oh
yeah. Sometimes, you know, it depends. Everybody has their own process.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Some people are very, they seem standoffish. But it's just, not.
Yeah.
You know, who knows how they are when you go out and you have a beer with them.
It's just part of the process.
Yeah.
Everyone has a different work process.
Yeah. Well, I'll give you this. Yeah. I don't know. You could decide later if you keep it in the show. I don't know. But the first thing Gandolfini said to me, I came up, we're rehearsing the scene, and he just turns to me, the pie on my scene, and he goes, ooh, 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 ooh. He's like, a bunch of fucking monkeys, kid. And I was like, what? He's like, a bunch of fucking monkeys. he's like, the show's been going downhill since season two.
No, he didn't.
When Nancy died.
Jesus Christ.
That's what he said. You probably shouldn't keep it.
Wow.
He's like, you missed the boat, kid. I was like, what? He's like, the show's been going downhill since Nancy died.
That's amazing. That's great. You're keeping that.
Yeah. Good. David Chase is never going to hire me again anyway. So.
The show's going down. Yeah.
Since season two. Yeah.
So that was the big break, Sopranos.
That was the big break that was like, you know, before Sopranos, when people would ask you, like, so what do? It was like a monologue to get to the point. Like, the punchline was, I'm an actor. But it was like, well, I'm bartending over at Turtle Bay and in Blackfin, and I work at California Pizza Kitchen. I'm taking classes, and, you know, I'm trying to be an actor. And then after Sopranos, people were like, dude, you're Tony's boy.
Yeah.
You know, and it was like, holy shit. It was like, I didn't have to say I was an actor.
Yeah, you're the same way, Dom, with the... When
all the side
we
jobs.
Had that question asked to you about when did you decide that you were an actor?
When was the moment you could?
Well, I get, you're an actor, right? What you been in? And you feel like, well, so what do I got to run everything down now.
Let me open Wikipedia.
So someone just asked me that the other day. They're like, is that? Oh no, actually, my son. Somebody came up to me the other day and said something, and it was specific. It was about City on a Hill, and we were at like a random carnival in Connecticut. And this guy came over and said something. And he was really nice and he was really specific. And we walked away. And my son goes, is that annoying for you? And I said, no, I love it. If a guy, if it's a, you know, nice person and they specifically know who I am and actually saw me and they know, they have something very specific to say. The worst is when they're like, what do I know you from? And then you're like listing your resume, and they're like,
No,
that's not you. You know what? I got to buy fucking compound, man. You get the fuck out of here.
That's you in Home Depot.
Home Depot all the time.
You walk away feeling like shit. You're like, said your whole, you're like defending your resume, and like they don't know any of it anyway. They're like, no.
That's what my girlfriend says. She goes, you should be a Home Depot model.
Yes. But this is great because we've had a bunch of interviews, and you know, people talk about his credits and what he's been in, and we've had this conversation several times where he was only in like three episodes of Entourage, and what we were doing,
we were golfing twice,
it's amazing.
Once.
People think you're in the whole show. We were golfing like 2 weeks ago, and we drive by, and these two, he gets out to look for his ball, and these two guys drive by, and right away they're like, dude, it's a fucking guy from Entourage. How about the wife?
By the way, I thought that was my Callaway. It was a fucking torn up ball.
I think it was a Srix on it.
Yeah.
By the way,
I stayed in.
Wait, is that true that you were only in three episodes of Entourage?
Yeah, that's it.
It's nuts.
That's a testament to your act. Because I would have thought you were way more.
And Doug Ellen can prove it. We had him on the show.
That's great.
It was great. It was.
I would have thought you. That's crazy.
I know.
That's actually crazy.
Yeah.
People are crazy, man.
But
now,
what I'm saying.
Well, the funny thing is, I was in a bar.
Yeah.
I was in a bar with Matt in L.A. Shout out to the Townhouse, Venice. We're there late night, and this one guy comes from across the room, and he's like, I fucking know you.
Yeah.
You know? And he's he goes, dude, you were in Scandal. It's fantastic. I love you. And he started mentioning scenes he was in, and he was like, all right. And we ended up hanging out with this guy for like, you know, two, 3 hours. Yeah. It was great.
See,
but
now,
he knew it.
That's something else.
Can I ask
you? So now, if he would have got the Sopranos, okay, he gets Scandal. Somebody comes. So what you're feeling is, oh, okay, people are seeing a lot of other different things. That it's not so much that you want to be recognized, but you want people to maybe point out something completely different than what you normally get.
How about them pointing out
the work that you've done versus just going
easy,
up
Rob
to you,
Starling.
Well, that's what the
take it easy. Take it easy.
Reminds me of Rod Sterling
in a world
in a new dimension. Why hasn't there been a movie about Rod Sterling?
There's a Twilight Zone movie.
No,
which was
a movie about him.
He was they should be.
There should be.
Yeah.
And Justin Theroux should play him.
Justin Theroux is fucking terrific.
He's a great guy.
Remember you? Did you watch The Leftovers?
Yeah.
That was great.
I did Miami Vice with him.
Can't believe they canceled that.
He's a great guy.
Before we get into I have one
more question. That's Tom Parada. That's the guy who did Mrs. Fletcher.
Oh, dude. Amazing. Leftovers. Yeah. Outstanding.
Anyway.
Is it more annoying people just staring at you, trying to figure out who you are?
None of it's annoying.
No, I'm not saying it's annoying, but if I'm eating dinner and there's a group of people going like this.
No.
Yeah, but you hate people.
Nine out of ten times, the person coming up to you is a really nice person.
Yeah.
See, this is why.
They're great. We're talking about that one person who comes up to you and tries to talk to you like they know you for 20 years and they want you to list your resume.
Yeah.
That happens every now and then. For the most part, everybody's always pretty cool with me.
Yeah. Same.
Yeah.
If it's something like huge in France for whatever, because that role was huge. So specific, people will come up and say,
Jason Allen Ross.
Jason Allen Ross. But people like that's nice because then I'm like, and they'll say specific things and I'm like, that's cool. That's really about the work, and that's awesome to hear. The flip side, like I was in New Orleans and I was doing this, I was like doing reshoots on this movie, and I went back, so I was now by myself. But when we were shooting the movie, it was like, you know, a couple of guys. We would go everywhere together. So we found this one place down in like the French Quarter, and we get this great omelet, whatever. So now I'm by myself, and I go back, and I love the place and everybody that works there, and it's kind of small. And I'm like sitting there, you know, whatever. I'm eating, and somebody came over that actually did know me from something, and that was really nice. But then everybody that was around that saw that was looking over, but they didn't know who I was, but they knew that somebody did. So then they're looking. So I started sweating bullets, because I was like sitting there eating and I felt like I was like in a fishbowl, and I'm just sweating and I'm trying to look nonchalant, and I'm like sweating through my shirt so bad. The woman came over, she's like, "Oh, baby, you gotta get you." She's like, "You okay?" And I was like, "No, I'm good. I'm like, if I get a napkin, I'm like drenched with sweat.
You got a towel?
But that's what I'm talking about.
quick shout out for Huge in France. Like me and Aaron, we were friends with Matt and Deirdre, and you know, we'd know each other for a long time. And he'd always pop up in a show and we'd be like, "Oh, look, it's Matt," you know, whatever. Yeah. When he told me he was gonna be on Huge in France, I was like, "Oh, there's this new show on Netflix." I was like, "Let's give it a, you know, let's watch." It's based on the French Jerry Seinfeld, this guy, Gad Elmaleh. And he's like, you know, the Seinfeld of France. But anyway, we watched that show. And it was normally I'll notice my friends and stuff, and I'd be like, "Oh, that's cool, he's in there, whatever." He wasn't even Matt to us in that show. We watched that show. It was fucking amazing. It was such a good show, and I have no idea what politics go on.
I
could not believe the way the show ended too. It was on Netflix. The show ended with the best episode was the last episode, and it ended with him on the floor of a bathroom, like half dying, half
so
coming back
left
to life.
With a cliffhanger.
And they didn't fucking renew it. Yeah. It's unbelievable. And you can still watch it on Netflix. It's like
Something weird happened. Thank you for saying that. But that was one of those ones, you will know this, when the material is just so good that you're like,
it's on
you're
the
like,
page.
I'm so lucky that I get to play this role. Like that role, if you ever see it, it's like it's so funny, and it's also, but it was just so well written. And the guys that wrote it, it's two guys wrote all eight episodes and directed all eight episodes.
More of that happening
now. Oh, dude, it was so much fun. It was a comedy. Yeah. Yeah. It was a comedy, but I probably had to cry in that more than any other.
I'm gonna check it out.
It was so good. These guys are so talented, and. It was like a joy to go to work. It was just awesome, you know.
another
10,000 no's.
Yeah, this is common ground for you guys as well, because Matt has had a podcast.
I gotta have you on.
Matt's had a podcast for years called 10,000
I would love
no's.
To do it.
Mine's and, not as mine's not as fancy as this feels like the real thing.
I gotta get need a couch.
I gotta get two dudes in the corner. I'm like me and a laptop. I have like
and we're taking donations.
My podcast is a styrofoam cup with a string.
It's him and a laptop in the honey wagon.
Yeah,
the two dudes are available anytime.
Hold on. My neighbor yesterday, he comes up, great guy, Tony Bonanno, and he comes up to me, he goes, you didn't need a couch, did you?
Tony next door?
He goes...
He gave up the couch?
No, he knows somebody that was selling a new couch, they were getting rid of, they're going to Florida, I don't know where they're going. I'm like, yeah, I need the couches. First of all, Apollo freaking chewed the couch upstairs, so we're due for a couch upstairs.
He's got a real dog problem.
Anyway, we're taking donations.
I like this chair. This is weird.
I bought that chair for here, and it didn't work, and it was too low. And
I think so, we should get a recliner.
So a common guest we both had on the show.
Henry Winkler.
Oh, yeah. You had Henry Winkler. Ah,
the nicest guy in Hollywood.
I think Henry Winkler's officially a saint.
Yeah. I'm sending him some sauce.
Actually, full circle to Huge in France. That's how I met him. He was at the premiere of Huge in France. We did we showed the first two episodes, and when my wife and I walked in, I had been watching Barry, and I go, there's Henry Winkler. I'm like, I never really go up to people. I go, I gotta go gush. I gotta talk to him.
And he's the Fonz.
He's the Fonz.
Be honest. He's the and fucking Fonz.
He was
not
with
Barry,
Max.
He's the Fonz.
The Fonz, for Christ's sake.
He was with Max, who I
he's
met.
He's Fonz, yeah.
But he got his Emmy. He got his Emmy.
Ralph Mouth used to kill me. I used to love what.
Ralph.
Yeah, Fonz, yeah.
He called me Potsy.
But the funny thing is, so you met him there.
Wait, did you go in for the Winklers?
So
tell me the story.
So
tell me the story.
I went in for wave. So I go in for Phil and Max Winkler. I go Phil Rosenthal.
Was Jake Johnson there?
It was Phil Rosenthal and Max Winkler.
Okay, no Jake.
No.
Okay.
So is that first or second round?
I don't know. I went in.
I think I was close to when you. Here's what happened. I go in thinking I have an audition because I don't ever have like meetings.
Okay. I'll give you my story.
All right.
But go ahead.
I go in. I meet Phil, and I just know that he's the Everybody Loves Raymond guy. And I'm like, I love Everybody Loves Raymond. And I go in. I walk in, and we just start talking. He's the greatest guy in the world.
Phil.
I've never seen
him. We had Phil on. Phil was our first guest.
It was so great. We just sit there and talk. We talk for a while. I leave. I don't even think I ever read. Maybe I read. Maybe they're like, oh, do you want to read? I was like, yeah, I'll read. I read. I feel good about it. They're really nice. I walk out, and it's to the point where I call my manager.
Who's in the waiting room?
No, there was like nobody.
Were you the first one or the last one?
I don't know. It was like
what
I didn't
time
see
of day was it?
He was
it was
the
during
one.
The day. It was like I don't know. It was like
during the day.
What were the coordinates?
It was like eleven o'clock. I don't know. 11 o'clock in the morning. 12 o'clock.
Latitude, man. Latitude.
It was like 20 years.
It was at Fox.
Yeah, I know. Yeah.
So I walk out, and it's to the point where it went so well that I called my manager, and I'm like, are they just offering this to me? Like it didn't even seem like they were going to test me. It seemed like they were the greatest people in the world, and they really liked me. And I was like, I've never experienced this before or since, where it was like the nicest people. It was like reading the thing was like a formality.
It was a nice room.
And they were like, they really liked you. And then I heard very soon after that you got it. And when I heard you got it, I was like, no joke. I was like, great fucking actor. And I'm like, he's more right for the role. Mm. I'm like, I could do it, but he's more right for the role.
Now, do you want to hear my story?
Yeah.
I appreciate that, man.
Yeah.
I appreciate the comment.
Now you want to hear my story.
Thank you very much.
No, I'm serious. That was my reaction. Usually I'd be like, fuck that motherfucker. But I really like your acting. So I was like,
That's how I feel about Bobby Cannavale sometimes. Like, oh, okay. They went with the fucking good looking one. All right. Damian and Blue Jasmine. All right. So this is what I've come to learn, because I'm really good friends with Phil. Phil, we had Phil here twice, actually, because we missed him the first time.
Dom may or may not have burned his guest house down.
Yeah. That's still...
Phil's guest house.
Oh, yeah, yeah. He did.
There's no evidence of that.
Just you jumping,
wait to hear this.
Just you jumping so, through the wall. Yeah,
I'm in LA. I'm filming The Gambler. You get a script, an audition. I get the script, and then I get the email with the appointment sheet. And I think it's a joke. I think my agent and manager, it's a joke.
Because
it's a fucking sitcom and it's a comedy. Yeah. And I don't do that.
You should definitely
right,
be in a
right?
comedy.
But somebody. You know what I mean. Yeah, you're always getting sent the same thing.
Yeah.
The bad guy, the heavy. I play the heavy.
Yeah.
Right? What's this? Is you serious? They're like, yeah, they really want to see you. Like, okay. Now, if you remember... The material, it was like 15, 16 pages. It was
you're the handyman who the like whole, lives in the
but
house.
But it was the whole
thing. Yeah, it was like the whole thing.
The whole
yeah.
thing. That was
yeah.
the audition.
Yeah.
So I'm like, okay, let me look at this stuff. And I, Everybody Loves Raymond was, I loved that show.
Yeah.
So I know who Phil was.
Yeah.
And but I didn't know Max. I didn't know Jake Johnson, and Jake happened to be in the room. I knew Jake is acting, but I didn't. He was producing this thing. He was partners with Max at the time. They might still be. So I'm preparing for this thing. I'm like, okay. I get to the floor, and I'm like, what the fuck am I doing here? I look like I'm the help in this room. I look like I should be sweeping the floor. It's all like really good looking.
By the way, that's the role. That's the fucking role.
That's the role, Dom.
Right.
He's the fucking handyman.
But this is network.
Yeah,
so
yeah. No. Oh, I got a good story about this.
You could be a great looking guy. And you know they throw you in a flannel shirt and you're a construction worker.
Now you're a schmuck,
right? Yeah. Now you throw up drywall. So I'm like, and I'm not gonna mention the actors that are there, but I'm like, well, I think I was next, and I literally left. I left. I went outside. I'm like, let them fucking go.
Did you think you bombed it or something?
I didn't go yet. I walked into the thing. You sign in and you wait, and everybody's fucking mumbling.
Now you're just trying to figure out
what that's what happens.
You're there.
Everyone's mumbling.
Yeah.
Their lines, or they're on their cell phone, or whatever they're doing.
Or they're telling everybody, yeah, just test it for.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly.
And I want no part of that.
Yeah.
I want no part of that when I go to an audition. I want no part of it. So I walk out and I start doing some push-ups.
On the street?
No.
That would be hardcore.
Because I started getting very nervous. I started getting very nervous. And I said, you know, let me get back to a place. So I'm trying to figure things out. You know, I wasn't worried about the material. I wasn't worried about any of that. I was worried about walking into that room and somewhat feeling kind of confident, but not showing them how nervous I was. Because this was a big deal. This is a sitcom. This was
network.
Heavy hitters involved.
P.S. Time out for a second. You're fucking regular on The Wire, like the greatest show on television. Yeah, this is how people don't realize...
This is
how
dumb,
fucked
though.
Up the actor's psyche is. Like, the fact that you're nervous for this is crazy, but I get it because I've been there.
I still get
but
nervous.
But go on.
I
yeah,
still
yeah,
get
I know.
Nervous.
No, I know. But I just want to interject for the audience, for you guys out there. Because you're a fucking great actor on the greatest show in history.
Like,
and it's like crazy.
People think like actors are like, you know,
yeah.
narcissists and they just have all this confidence.
So go on. Sorry.
It's
So you're doing push-ups.
So I do. So I see one of the actors come out. Hey man, what's up? Hey, yeah, what's up? You know, like the whole LA thing.
What's up? And,
yeah, what's up?
What's up, bro? What's
up, bro? Like, yeah, yeah, okay.
Nice belly, bro.
And and then I go. I walk in. So there's nobody there. There's nobody left. Nobody left. I made all these people go in front of
me. I must have been right after you because nobody was there. When I you must have cleared
like
the room.
I smoked like 5-8 cigarettes outside. There's probably like cigarette butts.
Circle of butts around your push-up square.
And yeah. Hey, Cameron, it's called balance. Okay? It's called balance.
That's great.
So I walk in and you hit the nail right on the head, Matt. It was a welcoming room, warm. So nice, and they're talking about all these. They're talking about Boardwalk Empire. They're talking about all these serious roles that I did. I'm like, fuck! I gotta be funny. I gotta be funny. Like in 5 minutes, I gotta like try to make these people laugh. So I finally start going, and then Phil goes. Okay, he stopped me like halfway point and just starts asking me these questions. And he's like, I saw, you know, I seen one. But Max and Jake wanted me to do the other scene. So then I had to do the other fucking 8 pages.
Wow.
I'm like, motherfucker. And I wind up doing it. And I wind up getting it. Mm-hmm. And then the whole other hurdle for me was the testing process.
Yeah.
The network. Because all those other shows I did before that, I never tested.
Yeah.
I never tested for network. I never tested for the studio. It kind of always happened a certain way for me. And I was very nervous about that. But Henry and I don't know if Henry didn't, I didn't know Henry, but Phil, man, Phil was so, so supportive.
Yeah.
So supportive. He got me through all that. I wouldn't have been able to get through it without Phil, man.
If you guys have not seen the movie, The TV Set.
No.
Oh.
You seen it?
Yes.
With Duchovny?
Yeah.
Jake Kasdan, I think, made it.
Yeah.
It's what it is. It's exactly what it is. It's a whole process of getting a show made.
It's a true interpretation.
And it's just like you, as an actor, you laugh and you cry. Because you're like, it's so funny and it's so
pathetic.
What
was the best part? The kid gets the pilot and he goes and buys a new car. Remember that?
Oh, no.
Yeah, I just got it, man. You know the show didn't get picked up.
What's the test? So for those not in acting, what's the testing phase? Do they test it on audiences?
Oh, testing is, okay.
Groups, focus groups.
There's all different ways that it goes down.
You're our choice. Mm-hmm. Like me and Matt, we're producing a show, mm-hmm. and we auditioned 5-10 people for the role, but we chose you.
Mm-hmm.
But now the studio and the network, well, sometimes both, right? I mean,
you go studio, and then if you get past that, you go to the network.
And that's... so now they want to see you, but what happens is they bring in 3 people, maybe 3 various different types.
Like different demographics?
Everything. Just, you know, person who came in and kind of showed, you know, some sort of interest that, you know, they showed some kind of, that was great. And basically, you're just singing, dancing for your food one more time. Then you do it one more time.
For these 3-4 people.
And when sometimes 10 people.
It varies in different places. I've done them where they're on the set. I actually like that. Like you go and you do hair and makeup and you actually shoot it on some other show's set. That's actually better because it's like you're going to work.
You're not
the other one, the worst one is, I think, what you're talking about. You go to the studio and then you go to the network and you go into it's like a conference room with like stadium seating. And there's people in suits sitting like, and they're like, you know,
oh,
they're on their phone like this.
No, the room wasn't no bigger than this.
And then you walk in Oh, I've done them. Yeah, you do them. Sometimes
they were right there.
It's like around like a long table, and everybody's there at seats, and it's bizarre. Yeah. And then sometimes you're in a room bigger than this, but it's like stadium seating, and they're in, you know, like movie theater seats, and they're literally in suits, and they're literally like they're texting, and then you come in, they're like, and this is Matt Del Negro. Hey. And you're like, hey, Dylan. They're like, so, how you feeling?
I think you see it in the. There was an episode of Entourage, where they kind of showed something like that.
It's rough. That's odd. It's rough because then you're like doing it like it's a play, but like it's
everyone
it's not
needs
a play.
To weigh in. Mm-hmm. You know, this is network television. A lot of money is involved.
Yeah, but these 20 people that are weighing in could be completely wrong.
They all have different agendas.
Well, that's the point. Yeah, that's why you know it's
that's up
better.
For debate.
There's 350 million people in the U.S. Yeah. 10 people aren't going to decide if.
Well, then you do
good.
A pilot. You shoot the pilot, and then they put it in front of what?
Again, no, you're right. Again,
then they put
more
it
focus groups, more shit like that.
Yeah. Then they put it a test audience.
Yeah, it's crazy.
And then people are watching it, turning knobs. I like that. I don't like that.
Then they go reshoot scenes because
and
of that.
I'm telling you.
And as an actor,
you get a score. How many people thought you were funny? How many people didn't like you?
That would fucking drive
it's like
me
a
nuts.
But that's what it is.
I know that's
they it's their way of crossing their T's and dotting their I's in order to push forward.
Yeah. So as an actor, you don't get paid until you get the role.
No. And you sign for 7 years. You sign and you know what you're going to make per episode.
Remember like what I did with the other... Remember that job?
Yeah.
Remember that job a few months ago?
Yeah.
That.
So that's the other thing. So
damn.
I did something and I got this. By the way, I never like, you know, I did this one thing and I got it. I went in, I tested and I ended up getting it. And I told my brother, I'm like, yeah, you know, went well. And he's not in this business at all. He's like in finance. And I'm like, yeah, it went great. I think they like me, but really they can replace me. And he's like, I thought you signed a contract. And I'm like, you did. He's like, how long is the contract? I'm like, 7 years. He's like, but they can fire you and replace you. I was like, yep.
They can replace you after.
I was like, that's what it is.
It's an NFL contract.
Yeah.
It's a one-way street kind of thing.
Now, based on this whole topic right here, just before we get to the hot seat, just one really quick, because you guys are both actors and you've been through so much of the same shit. Can you tell us, Matt, a little bit about your podcast, 10,000 No's, and how you got a subsequential book deal off it, but... Just for people who don't know that show, tell us a little bit about 10,000 No's.
So 10,000 No's is it came about when I was all the stuff we're talking about right now. I was working on Scandal. I was I had done a bunch of episodes at that point, and I was doing a movie in Utah, and I got a call, and they said, hey, so they want to use you for the next episode. I was just recurring though. I wasn't a contract role. So they're like, they want, you know, Shonda wants to use you next season. They're going to start here to here. There's going to be 16 episodes. They're going to go from this time. And then they're going to break for Carrie to have her baby. And then they're going to come back and shoot. And I was like, great. Awesome. You know? So you know, I was like, all right, I'm going to be in a bunch of this next season. We moved to be closer to where our kids were going to school. It was a little more expensive. And all of a sudden, the season came about, and it was just like I don't know if it was because Trump got elected. I have no idea. It's a Washington, D.C. show. I have no idea. Whatever happened, what I thought was going to be like 16 episodes turned out to be 3. So I'm like sitting there like it was pilot season. You know, I was like, you know, kind of going in feeling good about what I was doing in the room, but nothing's happening. So anyway, I had a buddy with a podcast, totally different feel, more like fitness or whatever. And I was just like, I just want to do something that I control, you know, right. That I am, even if it's 2 people listening, I just don't want to have to wait for someone else to hire me. And, you know, the 10,000 No's theory was just basically like, if you look at anybody, like I would, as you were saying, people look at you, they go, oh, you're an actor. Like people in a certain context, if someone knows me from a show, they have a whole image of what my life might be. And I'm like, that's
they don't
not
see,
my life.
They don't see all the rejection.
All the rejection, all the time you're not working, all the, you know, it's like, it's a totally different thing. It's not Entourage, you know? Mm-hmm. And so my theory was just basically, if I interview people that are, you know, in our industry, but also pro athletes, entrepreneurs, people that look like they're, you know, they've got this incredible life, you start to talk to them and just go, what did it take to get there? And then also, what is it really like? Like, what are your challenges? So that's, I started doing that. And I just love talking to people, getting these stories. And then one of the guests turned out to be an author, and he saw something I wrote and sent it to his publisher, and then ended up turning it into a book, which was really cool. And then now I have this like online community. I do this thing for young actors and filmmakers where it's like a live Zoom, and it's all the stuff that I talk about on the show, you know, because you'll interview like Henry Winkler or Kevin Bacon, and you talk to them, and Henry Winkler's like, you know, both of them, they're like, I don't know what my next job's going to be. They're like, you know, I know I'm going to work, but they still have that kind of from, as Kevin Bacon said, it's like, he's like, the cuts were so deep in the younger years that it never goes away. Mm-hmm. So it's like every actor you talk to, like, I'm shocked that you're saying you're nervous going in there, but I'm not shocked because I know the exact, you know, it's just like, it's a crazy thing. Mm-hmm. So anyway, now I did this thing where I had this like online community because I'm basically, I feel like I wish I had something like this when I was like 22, because I had no idea what I was doing. You know, it's like, who do you turn to? It's not like you go work in an office and you learn from the older guys. It's like, so you just like trial and error. So I started this thing and it's been cool. It's awesome. I see, you know, young actors and filmmakers that are kind of, they're talented, but they're struggling with like the mindset part of it. Like, how do you get through the tough times? Because it's freaking hard.
So many talented actors out there not working. I mean, if you look at our union, I mean, it's
Yeah, that's why it's like you go, it's, you feel so, you know, sometimes you get pissed off that you're not working more, and then other times you're like, holy crap, I get paid to basically, like, you know, play cops and robbers, you know.
Yeah, sometimes you get paid to wait.
You get paid to wait. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Wow. Yeah.
So yeah, thanks for asking. Yeah,
hey, I love it. Shout out to 1,000 Nos. There's been plenty of times over the years where, like, before we ever started doing a podcast, I would just go and click on his stuff and listen to it, and a lot of good insight and a lot of positive. One time I was trying to raise money for the film that I'm making, and I was in a cold spell, and I'm like, how am I going to do this by myself? And he called me, and he's like, hey, he goes, I just did a whole episode about cleaning out my garage. He goes, just listen to the episode and then go clean your garage. I swear to God, I cleaned the garage, and the next day I closed $150,000. It was insane. It was an insane story. I was like, listen to the garage show.
It's like Don LaPree, you know, remember?
I got enough money to go ahead and make some characters and sign some people.
That's actually one of the coolest things.
Put it in the paper.
I don't know how it is with this show, but I get like those emails, like you were asking before, what's it like if someone comes up and says something? I get emails about the podcast that are really cool to get, because those are always very specific. Super, like, it helped someone in some like really very, very specific way. And that's like, I'm like, oh, good. All right. You're not wasting my time. Because sometimes I'm like, I literally feel like I have like a styrofoam cup and a string, and you got a styrofoam cup. Yeah. And there's sometimes where it's like, I would do those Monday morsels where I'm just like talking, and I'm just freaking riffing into my laptop about some topic that I'm going through,
right?
And you're like, this is either really cool or I'm fucking batshit crazy.
That's,
I don't know where.
Right before you showed up, it was great. All right, put him in a hot seat.
All right, you're on a karaoke stage. What song are you singing?
In a town without a name.
Oh,
in a heavy downpour.
Holy shit.
Thought it cast its own shadow.
Jukebox hero.
By the backstage. Yeah. That's one of them.
Just one guitar.
You blew him away. Bam. He got stars in his eye. Bam.
Yeah.
And the very next day.
Oh, that's great.
Beat him up six.
Straight. Jukebox hero.
From the second hand stone.
You hit his tuning fork right there. That's great.
What's one of your biggest pet peeves?
Holding the door for someone and they don't say thank you.
I almost want to shut the door in their face.
Happen a lot. Happen
you're welcome.
Yeah, you're welcome. Exactly. Strong.
As I've gotten older and more mellow, I don't think I do that anymore.
You know,
but I want.
What pisses me off recently more than most things, like when you turn on a movie and someone pulls out a fucking cell phone in the middle. Like if you're watching a movie and someone pulls out a cell phone, it's like once the movie goes on, the cell phones go away.
Totally.
Like, I can't stand it. Someone takes time to put together a piece of art. And you can't give it, you know, 2 hours to watch. If you make the decision to put it on, just fucking watch it. Give it a chance. Don't tell me it sucks afterwards when you didn't pay attention.
Yeah. It's like when somebody talks while I'm listening to a song. It's like, shut the fuck up.
One more, because I got to say it, because I did it. I experienced it today. Driving in the left lane when you're not passing. So everybody's stuck behind the two cars. Because that guy in the left is just driving along. Like,
meanwhile, there's nobody in front of either of them.
Nobody in front of either of them. It happened today. And I'm with my son, and I'm getting so fat. And I go by, and I'm like, he has no idea he's doing that.
They love doing that on the Hutch. The Hutch.
Oh, dude. Yeah. That drives me nuts.
The worst. When there's two lanes, the worst.
I think we got to go with this question.
Uh-oh.
Yeah, I know what you're thinking.
Uh-oh.
If you could go back in time and give yourself a piece of advice, how old are you and what's that piece of advice?
Wow. Stole that from 10,000 No's. I don't like having the tables turned on me.
Oh. He doesn't even know.
How does it feel now? How does it feel?
Well, I would say this is a trick question. Because you'd only be where you are if you did the things you did. So I wouldn't listen to the advice. Man. But...
yeah.
Maybe I would say when I was a younger actor, I would say, you know, go like build another thing. Like you can go do this other thing and build it to come back to like the podcast that I did when I was 45. You could kind of go do that earlier. And set yourself up. Instead of like doing the hook or by crook the way I did it, sometimes I wonder if I was too like, you know, too much of a good boy of like trying to like approach this career in a conventional manner of like, and maybe I would say like, you know,
more outside the box.
Yeah, go more outside the box. I think I could have gone more outside the box, and I don't know if I would have listened to myself.
Pace yourself.
What's that?
And pace yourself.
But you're 100% right, though. Even with the mistakes that you did do in the past, you wouldn't have been here without those mistakes.
Right. So I did it the way I did it. So it is. It's always like
that's a person, different take on the question that we've gotten in the past.
But that's a different. Yeah, you're.
Yeah, I like it.
Yeah. I mean, you're associating the question only with
a career thing.
With the career.
Okay, so
you could say that in life in general.
No, but
man.
He's absolutely right. If you're associating that question with your career,
right? But in a personal.
What
way?
About in your personal life? What about something that got lost? And if things were differently, you would still have that. Doesn't necessarily change you not being an actor or anything like that. It really doesn't alter any of those things.
I'm not a no regrets kind of guy. I have plenty of regrets.
How did you?
Yeah, so do I.
I'm not that guy. I wish I could go back and do things differently and hopefully end up.
I'm glad I'm not being asked this question.
Yeah, I'm going to ask. I'm going to ask you this.
And I'll be ready.
He's going to bring out like a PowerPoint when I answer.
Yeah, I was waiting for that, man.
He's got scrolls.
Yeah.
Chapter one. I don't know. I kind of feel like my answer would be the same. Like, I mean, all the shit that I did that was dumb or decisions I made or mistakes I made, whether personal or career, they all like... somehow they may have got me to where I am the slow way or whatever, but that's how it worked out. I don't know.
You still got here.
No.
I don't know. That's a great. I don't know. Maybe I'm going to call you tomorrow.
Is there a movie that has ever made you cry?
Absolutely.
Do you know? You remember?
I'd say, you know. I'm trying to think of what. Kramer versus Kramer. Oh, that's a, you know, the champ.
That's deep.
The champ.
I said the champ.
There it is. The champ,
Rudy.
That got
it. I want to remake that movie.
The champ.
Yeah.
That should be remade.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
That's a great one.
I think they kind of almost did that with Southpaw, right?
Was that with Jake Gyllenhaal?
Yeah. Kind of.
Yeah, that was good. That was a good film.
Very good film. Do you have a hero?
My hero is me. 10 years from now. And I'm chasing
10 years from now.
I'm chasing him when I get there.
He'll be waiting.
Outstanding.
How many times are you jacking off every week?
Yeah.
You gotta up them numbers. You gotta up.
Three times a day.
That's Pat's honest answer.
And with that, Matt, thank you for stopping by, man.
Dom, thank you, Brad.
Real pleasure.
In person.
In the den, yeah.
We didn't get his opinion about aliens or anything.
Oh.
Because you're the only one that thinks about aliens.
What else am I going to think of?
Thank you guys for having me. Thank you.
Thanks, Matt.
All right, everyone. Three. Let one get done.